Okay, everybody, thanks for coming. I know it's late. I know beer is on your mind. I want you to listen up and try and avoid falling asleep at your desks, pupils, because this is actually quite important. The current EU copyright reform is shaping up to be a bit of a disaster, and you need to know about it and do something about it. Giannis.
Hello. My name is Giannis Konstantinidis. I've been part of the Mozilla family for like 4.5 years so far. Fair enough. And more recently, I have become a Mozilla tech speaker, which means that I often travel worldwide to speak at conferences about free and open source software technologies and open standards. And here is my friend and colleague, Gerv.
Hi.
Would you like to introduce yourself?
Well, I'm trying to get the slides to work, so perhaps now is not the moment. Okay. Hi, I'm Gerv. I've been with Mozilla for about 17, 18 years. I'm currently working in public policy, so that means persuading governments not to make stupid laws about the internet. So what we're talking about is what I do. I also run MOS. If you were here this morning, you'd have heard about that. And I try and stop dodgy certificate authorities from undermining the security of the web.
Apparently, I cannot fix the slides, so it's your call, I guess. Well, I'm not that much of a trackpad user, I'm more like a touchpad user. So I find it really hard to control ThinkPads using the trackpad. Apologies for the delay. Okay, off we go. So this is a quick overview of what we will be discussing about today. We will start with a quick introduction to the EU copyright reform. Then we will try to explain how this can potentially affect the FLOSS ecosystem, and not only the FLOSS ecosystem, but also the internet generally. Then we will also try to explain why all of this is happening. And before going to Q&A, we will also explain what Mozilla is currently doing about this and how you can also participate and demand better reform from your MEPs. So what is really going on? Last September, the European Commission published a proposal for a directive on copyright in the digital single market. You can search for it online using your favorite search engine. Just search for a proposal for a directive on copyright in the digital single market. Long story short, this proposal for a directive contains lots of articles that can potentially be very harmful not only for the free and open source software ecosystem, but also for the internet in general. In particular, there is Article 11, also known as ancillary copyright, which pretty much says that anyone using snippets of journalistic online content must first obtain a license. And this is targeting primarily search engines, such as Google. For example, you might have heard of Google News. What they do is they use snippets from linking back to the original source. So what the European Union is currently suggesting is that in order to use snippets, which in practice it's just a small piece of text linking to the original source of a journalistic article, they are saying that you must obtain permission. And by obtaining permission, most of the times you will end up paying fees to the respective copyright holders. This cannot be sane. We have been calling this the link tax, because this is what it really is. And even worse, this right would be in effect for 20 years after the original article's first publication. So it's not something that lasts for 7 days, for 7 weeks, or 7 months. It lasts for 20 years, almost an eternity. In addition, there is Article 13, also known as robocopyright, which pretty much says, in a nutshell, it says that platforms, internet platforms hosting user-generated content must constantly monitor user behavior to identify and prevent copyright infringement. This is a huge violation to user privacy. Can you imagine that? Constantly be monitored by algorithms in platforms. Gerv will also talk in a few minutes about this in more detail. But even if we consider that monitoring users is a good thing, which of course is not. Even if we do consider it's a good thing, still, it's such a large technological feat to be implemented by those platforms. They would need to design algorithms for monitoring users. They would need to find the resources to allocate it, to allocate them for monitoring their users. It's not something everybody can do. Large companies can afford to do that. They have the manpower, they have the resources to do such kind of monitoring. But not everyone can do that. So small and medium-sized enterprises are doomed. And of course, with Article 13, there comes a large set of problems. These platforms could potentially be held liable for the content that their users upload. Everything will need to be licensed so that it can be categorized accordingly. And there would be filters so that everything and anything will be monitored. Last but not least, there won't be any safeguards. The European Union will not be able to tell whether companies are overstepping. And also the users, they won't have any way of petitioning, of trying to appeal in case their content gets taken down without any reason. And it's not just about Europe. This proposal for a directive might be seen as best practice, although if you ask me, it's far away from being a best practice. This cannot be sane. It might although be seen by other governments as best practice and try to be replicated. And in reality, it's the same rights holders and creative companies that are trying to push for the same kind of legislation in other countries, such as the United States. So back to you.
So, how did it come to be that Article 13, that is supposed to be stopping people from uploading...
It's normal.
Yeah. No. I've turned it off on purpose. How did it come to be that Article 13, which is designed to stop people uploading commercial music and movies to YouTube, ended up being a problem for free software? The answer is that the EU doesn't really know what a platform is. There's a very loose definition of platform in the legislation. And it says, the legislation is targeted at, quote, information society service providers that store and provide access to large amounts of works or other subject matter uploaded by their users. So it's supposed to be about commercial audio and video copyright infringement, and but it can negatively affect GitLab, Stack Overflow, GNU Savannah, GitHub, SourceForge, and Software Heritage, right? They are information society service providers that store and provide access to large amounts of works or other subject matter uploaded by their users. That fits those companies pretty well, doesn't it? So, what do you have to do if you're covered? Maybe it's not so bad. Well, first of all, you're obliged to conclude licensing agreements with rights holders. So this means you need to have a department that whenever someone who owns some proprietary software comes to you, you have to make an agreement with them that you will monitor your users for uploads of their proprietary software. We have open source licenses, right? So there won't be a problem with general open source uploads because everybody who uploads to GitHub gives a license because it's open source, right? More on that later. But the second thing you have to do is you have to prevent the availability on the service of works or other subject matter identified by rights holders through the cooperation with service providers. So in other words, when the proprietary software company gives you their source code, you have to scan every bit of source code uploaded to check whether it's the same. And if it's the same in some way, you have to bar access to it. So each site, we need a submissions process for commercial source code, and then have to scan all commercial source code against it. The thing is, though, free software, public software, does not have a copyright infringement problem of that type. When was the last time you read an article about the scandal of someone uploading a pirate copy of the Microsoft Word source code to GitHub? Or, for that matter, a binary of Microsoft Word to GitHub? What is the equivalent of music or movie piracy? Well, it's that. but it makes no sense in a software context. So it's not like YouTube, these sites. Public software is necessarily publicly disclosed, so copyright problems are obvious. Their licenses are attached, unlike random bits of video. But even if we did say it could be done, the necessary monitoring would be too intrusive. You would need to be doing permanent, continuous license compliance assessment. And you'd have a massive false positive problem, because unlike music and movies, some source code is the same as other source code for legitimate reasons. How many ways are there of writing quicksort? How often do you copy and paste it from Stack Overflow? Right? And that would trigger false alarms and cause your software to be put in legal limbo until you could prove that that particular algorithm was in fact yours to use. And copyright compliance for source code is not an automatable thing anyway. There is an entire industry of billions of dollars of companies who go to proprietary companies and help them make sure their open source using product is in copyright compliance. They do use automated tools for it, but it's a manual process. And they're saying that now we have to basically do copyright compliance, as in a licensing compatibility between two libraries you've used in your project, would count as a violation of the rights of one of the copyright holders, and therefore possibly fall under this. So we now have to figure out how to do something that a very large industry hasn't figured out how to do, and make sure that anyone hosting their own copy of Git is running that software. The whole thing is a disaster zone. So lack of clarity means it has massive side effects, which are unintentional, unwanted, and that's even before the effects it's supposed to have, which are also unwanted. So that is why Article 13 is a complete nightmare for free software, and why, even if you don't really care about people pirating music and movies on YouTube, and you think, well, they do that, I don't do that, whatever, no problem, you need to be opposed to this copyright change and do something about it.
Thank you. Okay, all set. So why is this all happening? Well, if you ask me, it's more like a political problem rather than an intellectual one. Because, you know, politicians, they often run for elections. And in order to run for elections, they do need money, lots of money, to fund their campaigns. On the other hand, creative companies, rights holders, have lots of money, lots of power, lots of influence. So you can probably imagine what is really going on here. I don't really need to say anything more. Furthermore, politicians sometimes are technologically illiterate and therefore are conflating. They are not able to distinguish creative industries from creators. This is not necessarily the same thing. And lately, the European Union seems to be so much obsessed with getting Google, with trying to punish Google, to fine Google, to make them pay. The truth is that large, colossal companies such as Google, they have lots of power, lots of influence, lots of money, and whatever you might try to do to them, they will just smile at you and keep on going. They can afford to pay any fines. They will find ways to get away with it. So in the end, it's the small and medium-sized enterprises that are going to pay the price, not Google, not the colossal large companies. And last but not least, there is the myth of the value cap, as told by the creative industry, by the music industry in particular. Long story short, they are saying that with the internet, everybody is able to upload content digitally, and by spreading copyrighted content without paying for the fees, they are creating a huge value gap. That is, the creative industry is not getting their money back. So what is Mozilla doing about all of this? We have heard a lot of campaigns, successful campaigns, such as Paperstorm. You can still go to paperstorm.it to find out more about this particular campaign. In a nutshell, it was a campaign where people could sign a petition, and once they signed a petition, we would drop digital leaflets, digital non-tangible leaflets, over buildings, such as the FCC building, or over important monuments, such as the Eiffel Tower. And in total, we did drop more than 65 million digital, non-tangible, of course, leaflets. And once we reached our milestones, we would tweet directly to key people, such as MEPs, members of the European Parliament. And apart from Paperstorm, there are other campaigns. There is, for example, the Change Copyright campaign, which you can visit right now, right this minute, or right after this session at changecopyright.org. You can sign the petition, and we can also connect your call to the European Parliament to speak with your representative, to speak with a member of the European Parliament. And we also provide you with a text that you can read to your representative and therefore demand better reform. Apart from the changecopyright.org campaign, there are other ways with which you can help. For example, you can always keep up to date with all the latest updates we have around our initiatives, around our campaigns. And if you would like to lend us a helping hand, you are more than welcome to do so. Come speak to us right after the session. Come find us in our booth in the K building. And, well, let's fight together and let's demand better reform by our governments, by our representatives in the European Parliament. Thank you. And we do have 5 minutes for any questions you might have. Okay. I'm going to repeat the question. Yes, please. Yes, you. So she's asking. Okay. Yeah, fair enough. She's. What?
Further away from your mouth.
Sorry?
Further away from your mouth.
Test? Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I will repeat the question. So she's asking if this is a proposal and if the proposal has already been voted, if something has been decided. So the proposal came out last September and the next voting is set to take place in March. Nothing has been decided yet. It is merely a proposal, but like we said earlier, it contains several articles that can be very harmful, not only for individual citizens, but also for small and medium-sized enterprises. Thank you. Yes, please. Another question? Yes, please.
What other concrete actions are you taking other than calling the MEPs?
So the question is, what other concrete actions can we take apart from calling the MEPs? Well, it's a political issue, like I said earlier. So personally, if you ask me, I don't know of any other ways which we can, you know, take immediate action and try to demand better reform. It's a political issue, it's a complex issue. Large organizations such as Mozilla, large companies are lobbying directly with members of the European Parliament, and well, I personally hope that progress is going to be made and that we don't have to face such challenges in the near future. Would you like to add something? Yes.
If you sign up at changecopyright.org, we'll let you know when there is something that you can do other than calling your MEP.
Thank you. Do we have another minute for one last question? Okay. Yes, please.
It doesn't apply to... I don't think it applies to links, no. It's not one of those things where even if you link to something, you have to check it's valid. It's only content that you yourself host. Sorry, the question was, does it apply only to hosted content, or does it also apply to content you link to?
Thank you. I think we're done. Thank you very much for being here. Come find us right after the session.